Phil Trussell, who's here, whose paintings I talked about before. His father, Jake Trussell, was a real fine poet. He was in nearly all of the border portrait anthologies edited by Robert Rhodes in the mid-30s and mid-50s. And John Cobb's mother, Bill Cobb Worsby, was a fine poet. So here we have two poets, and their sons turn out to be painters. So we can't complain about that, as long as they're producing art like this. But anyway, there's that close connection between portrait and painting. And what it is, it's an attempt to perceive the reality behind the reality, the behind the behind. And so that's why I say John is easily put within that tradition of American transcendental realism. We look at the great fountainhead of it in Thomas Aikens, and people like Edward Hopper and the Ashcan School students of Robert Henri there in New York City. And one of the key of those is John Sloan, who had a tremendous influence on Southwestern painting, people like Peter Hurd, for instance. And John Sloan is a good friend of my father, my best friend, Jerry West, one of the best painters in Santa Fe. So my all-man partner, J.P. Vine, in my mining endeavors, his aunt stepped into John Sloan in New York City. So John Sloan is one of my favorites of that Ashcan School. So anyway, in transcendental realism, what I'm talking about is that effort by the artist, by the painter, go beyond what he's seeing, to project his own vision, his own personal vision. And so I'll be talking about these paintings one by one. I'll hand them to John, and he'll pass them around, because these small paintings, he helps me to look at them up close. And he'll add some comments to them too. This first one, for instance, hand it to me, son, is just a simple rose, and is given to my daughter for a wedding gift. And so, again, I said simple rose. Was it Gertrude Fanning said, "Where the rose fell asleep in the old rain"? But anyway, John did this on May 9th, and I think it's an outstanding painting myself. So, John, do you have anything to add to that?
Only that he done were good. It, the thing happened so quickly. And in many ways, you have to be prepared ahead of time for the thing that will happen. Yeah. So,
you're ready.
Yeah, it's a... it's kind of a frame of mind that you have to carry with you for when it appears.
Frame of mind.
Sorry.
Next one.
This is belongs to my son. It's in his collection. And this is the first painting anyone ever gave to him. John gave this to long time ago, again, Brooklyn Art. So this is a seascape I guess who runs this past. This is somewhere on the Texas coast.
It's got the words on the bag.
Yeah.
You read it. Oh.
Yeah, you read it, and I can't see that.
From Song of the Isthmus. Grave by then through the red, on a pole and daring Balboa's head, who found the southern sea.
Found the southern sea.
Where you remember it?
No, that's the words of William Skelly Burford.
William Skelly Burford. Yes. That's equally provocative, and so we'll pass it around also. But I would not
can with two paintings along the seashore. This one I did from the flagship. I understand that it was partially destroyed by the last one of the storms.
It was destroyed.
It was destroyed. Have they taken it down?
It's gone. It was gone.
The flagship was gone?
Yeah, it was gone after the storm.
God.
The storm, it took it away. The view's still there.
The view is there.
This is just just some big lava boulders on the plane up in Folsom, New Mexico. I had this nice cabin in fact about 30 years ago. The cabins with iron shingles when I first got it. And he created a peaceful kingdom. I came in and gave some notice. First time I visited him up there, he was up there. A Babbitt family had made their nest underneath the house, hadn't they, John? And they made a little hole in the wall, and the mother Babbitt would come out and sit there and look at us while we were talking. And it was a peaceful kingdom. Frank Waters was a great friend, a great American mystic, wrote the Book of the Hopi, The Man Who Killed the Deer, in Mexico State. And he would appear in my dreams often when he and I were both alive. And I've seen him quite a few times in my dreams after he passed away. And one of the dreams, he and I were sitting on a stage in a gymnasium. And there were all these dancers in the gym, and they were all wearing kachina masks. There's always spirit in the world. And I replied telepathically, even in the rocks? He said, yes, even in the rocks. So this is my spirit rock here, John. I mean, it's incredible boulder, it's an incredible painting. You know, so not many people would this painting have even occurred to them, would it? Be honest now. Very few people would have even occurred to them. But through your realism, you touch on that magic behind the reality. A deeper inner magic is one of my favorites.
Another one that hangs in my room.
Do you know where that was made?
Yeah, near Folsom, New Mexico.
And where?
It owns a lot of it, so just down from Folsom. Down from Capitan, there's a national monument there. It's the youngest volcano except for Paracutan on the North American continent. So,
well, it's wind. When we leave the highway, it's quite as...
Yeah, that's it.
When you leave the highway, it's always difficult to transgress on somebody's property. It is like a dilemma. You know, do I have the right to this property? Is this property mine? Is this property a contention? So whenever you cross a fence, you have to think about all those things, and sometimes you just go ahead and go on. So I just went on and climbed this hill and got to the place where these boulders were. You could see it from the road, but it's not like getting off the road and being a part of it and set my stuff up and do these stones. It's just hard to believe that they could occur. It's almost as if they were spit out. And landed, they were.
They're beautiful, aren't they, John?
Yeah, they form the most incredible arrangements. Now, I know that there's a religion, the Buddhist religion, that composes the stones. But I felt as though this were more archaic, that the stones were there. And it depended upon your view.
Right. These next two are two of my favorites also. Again, they're all my favorites. Pardon for sounding like a broken record. But these are particular landscapes. And notice the way John handles the light and shadow. This is a scene near Burnett, Texas. And but he gets an incredible sense of distance the way he does those skyscrapers. And so he's as good at doing the clouds as he is the land. And that means a lot to me, John, you know, that you do those cloudscapes so well. And so anyway, these two paintings here, I think, could send up to any of the best art of the high Dutch and Italian Renaissance. That's my summation of it. So I'll pass them out and submit them to you. This one here is near on the Barlett River, and there are some small figures here. John does them extremely well. I'm amazed. And this was a study for a larger painting. I don't know if you've ever found the time to do it. This is the Barlett River. Again, the way it does the clouds, it gets just this immense feel of distance and movement. And that's that spiritual quality that we're all looking for in this art.
The water, the earth, and the sky.
Regular oil paint or other forms of paint. Very resistant.